We are a country that have a very interesting past. And Zahi Hawass represents all that is wonderful in the past of Egypt.
All major discoveries happen by accident. You never know what the sand of Egypt might hide of secrets.
He has made ancient Egypt accessible to many, many more people who would never, ever have access to it.
Well, Zahi Hawass is the best, really, to represent Egypt.
Everybody knows who he is. He's a very articulate and enthusiastic spokesperson for Egypt.
When I was born, just 5 years before the revolution, then I grew up with the revolution. It wasn't the time of President Nasser talking about freedom and talking about education to everyone. I mean, all of this gave inside me things that built my personality.
He's a doer. He's that kind who can come up but never come down.
One of the few people that I know were capable of doing 10 things at the same time.
Women can multitask. He's one of the only men I've met who can multitask, which I think is unique. So there's something positive about his X chromosome and his mother's strength.
The people adore him because he is a wonderful actor. I think his best quality is acting. He is the greatest actor I've ever seen.
You get a whole bunch of people wanting to do archaeology because they've seen the films. So they've seen the TV and they also see Indiana Jones.
And especially maybe to Egyptians, he is a national treasure.
Yeah, I like him very much. He's like our father, yeah.
He's very informative and he knows what he's talking about.
He's on TV everywhere and he really comes across as very welcoming and inviting people to come here and learn about the history.
This is what all the tourists say to me. We came to Egypt because we saw in the TV. We came to Egypt because of you.
And this is Zahi Hawass.
Yes.
Oh,
thank you.
You many times before in German TV.
Oh, yeah, German.
Oh, nice from you.
Thank you. Sometimes I became unhappy because I'm famous. Because I can't do anything. People look at me all the time. When I did open the tomb, I did crawl on my chest for about 15 meters above the stone rubble with a flashlight in my hand.
Some Egyptians think that he's great and some think he's an awful self-publicist.
There are people who attack him because he is shining. He is shining like a sun, really.
Ce monsieur est un animal de médias. Il s'intéresse aux médias beaucoup plus que l'égyptologie.
I think he's one of those people that you either love or hate. And there's the in-between is not very feasible.
I joined the archaeology department by accident. I had no idea that archaeology is going to be everything in my life. Actually, I hate that person.
Zahi Hawass now became a model for all of us. Every one of us wants to be Zahi Hawass. But of course, nobody can be like him.
He is one of the Egyptian icons.
I was the most famous Egyptian before Zahi Hawass became the most famous Egyptian in the world.
Zahi Hawass will be forever in the memory of the Egyptology history.
Thank you very much.
I'm very happy that finally I'm able to come back and talk to you about some of my work in Egypt. But before I will do that, let us see an important part of our history, which is actually the 25th of January revolution, and how, what happened to the Cairo Museum in that night, the night of the 28th of January. It's a night I will not forget in my life. It's a night that I did not sleep at all because I heard about all these thousands of people who really appeared in Tahrir Square, and all of them want to get rid of the regime. But the most difficult thing that I heard is about stealing the Cairo Museum, how people really entered inside the Cairo Museum. On the 29th in the morning at 8 o'clock, I came to the Cairo Museum, and I found out that the young people protected the Cairo Museum. They told me, we protected the museum for you. When I entered inside, I found the army commander, but I saw around head of a mummy. I thought that those people entered inside the museum and they robbed all the mummies because people in Egypt were looking for something called red mercury. And red mercury, it's a legend. Something doesn't exist at all. They think there is something exists in the throat of the mummy that can cure people and also bring the devils. But when we entered inside the Cairo Museum and we saw the mummies that we discovered in our team, we found out that actually 28 cases thrown in the ground. All the masterpieces were there. Thanks God that Cairo Museum was actually dark. They could not see the treasures. And the second important thing, they were looking for gold. And this is why, how they entered the museum. They went from the back of the museum to the top, and they saw these glasses. They broke the glasses. And after that, they came 8 meters down with wires, and they hit these glasses. One of the looters broke his legs, and actually you can see the blood. We could notice that blood everywhere. And we were able to see how many glasses they broke, looking for gold everywhere. And we began to collect artifacts, and we began to restore, looking at the thieves. I asked them, why did you steal the Cairo Museum? They were faceless. They could not really say a word, but they were looking for gold. Actually, you can see they broke coffins because they look for mummies. And we brought to the conservation room all the artifacts that has been stolen. And you can see one of the great things is this statue of Keynote of Tutankhamun above a panther. Look really how it looked like before. It was pieces like this. The restorator restored it and until it became complete like this. This is how all the artifacts has been restored inside the Cairo Museum. They broke both like this, and there is a rumor happened that the golden mask has been stolen. Of course, if the golden mask has been stolen, it's a big thing. I had to make a press conference. I brought reporters from all over the world, and I told them that the golden mask is there. I have to thank all the army commanders and the young people who really protected the Cairo Museum. What's missing now? Only 28 small objects from the Cairo Museum. 28. Look what happened in Baghdad. 15,000 artifacts were stolen. And this is why we have to thank the army commanders and the young people who really saved the museum. But after the revolution, people began to attack antiquity sites. And that's something that made of us, all of us, to have tears. Because to build cemeteries above antiquity sites, you destroy history. And that's really what's happening now in Egypt. And I hope that soon all of this could be completely stopped. But at least I hope that this revolution will help us to slow down and to think about our country, because many people doesn't think about this country now. Let us start. The most important work that I began is the restoration of the oldest pyramid in Egypt, the Step Pyramid of Zoser. The burial chamber is about 29 meters long. We cleaned inside, and we can see the remains of the sarcophagus with the word in hieroglyphic means south. I mean, they put blocks to put it in the south side. Also, we made a scaffolding inside the burial chamber, 29 meters, to restore the burial chamber. We can see hieroglyphic inscription here to say that this pyramid has been restored in 500 BC. And this is the team that has been working inside the step pyramid until now. Most of the work that we do in Egypt, many discoveries happened by accident. I've been excavating in this area since 1988. And look at the complete luck. We had a big mound of sand in this area. We began to remove the sand underneath. We could discover a pyramid about 5 meters left from this pyramid. The pyramid was cased with limestone, and it was about 15 meters high. When we did actually, if you look at this pyramid was cased with white fine limestone. When I did announce the discovery of this pyramid, it entered the hearts of everyone, because to discover a pyramid, to make the number of pyramids to be 123 pyramids. We began to enter to the burial chamber. We found the entrance is completely sealed. We had to go from that hole that opened by thieves in antiquity. We found the sarcophagus. The lid is about 8 tons weight. We had to bring people who really knows how to move heavy stuff, like this guy, Ahmed Ekreti. He just died about 3 days ago, but he's really wonderful man in moving heavy stuff. We moved the lid, and we found underneath remains of the queen. This is the legs of the queen, but we could not find her name. But actually, I believe that this could be the pyramid of the wife of the king, or maybe the mother of the king, Titi, who's the first king of dynasty six. We opened the main entrance to the pyramid, and you can see how the Egyptian really made the entrance to be completely sealed with granite like this. Another major important discovery happened by accident is we caught a thief digging in this area here. And of course, if the thief found a mud brick wall, I had to bring my team, and we began to excavate, and we found some impressive, beautiful tomb, like this tomb. Entering inside, it has a false door, and above the man who was a priest, and his father had another false door in the other side. Underneath is the burial chamber, about 20 meters down. How do you go down the false door? The only way is to use baskets like this, and you go down step by step until you actually enter inside the burial chamber, where you discover alabaster jars, and you discover a jar in the shape of a duck inside bones, an obelisk that once stood in front of that tomb. The other tomb that we found is next door to this tomb. It's a tomb dated to the Old Kingdom and used in the 26th dynasty, about 500 BC. When we entered inside, I found myself in front of about 60 mummies. Some were completely sealed underneath a coffin like this, dated 500 BC. Of course, when you discover a mummy, you'll find all the media will become interested in coming to this important discovery. Now I take you to a place that I never thought in my life that I would be working in this place. It is the Valley of the Kings. The Valley of the Kings contain 64 tombs now. The tombs were covered with beautiful scenes and books like the Book of the Gates and the Book of What in the Netherworld. All these books has to help the king until he can go and meet Osiris in the afterlife. Of course, the most important discovery that we always remember is the discovery of the tomb of Tutankhamun, the famous word that Lord Carnarvon asked Howard Carter when the tomb was found, what do you see? He said, wonderful things, wonderful things. I do have a discovery like this, the Valley of the Golden Mummies at Bahriya Oasis, where we found a big valley contain thousands of mummies. I removed about 250 mummies, but actually the mummies were covered with gold like this. And it came to an important discovery of tombs underneath the houses of the village. But the houses have no sewage system. Then it was really terrible to excavate underneath and find these tombs underneath the houses. But the sewage and the smell of the sewage was a big problem. We came through major important things, a big sealed sarcophagus. My assistant asked me the same question that Lord Carnarvon asked Howard Carter. He said, what do you see? I was smelling the sewage, and I said, shit. Now, we come again to the important discovery of the tomb of Tutankhamun. When I sat in the Valley of the Kings, thinking, what is really left to be discovered? The tomb of Tutmosis II is not found yet. The tomb of Ramses VIII is not found yet. The tomb of all the queens of dynasty 18 were not found yet. Means the valley could contain lots of important things that can be discovered. But I tell you a story that happened to me almost 35 years ago, when I was a young man working in the Valley of the Kings, and I met this man, Sheikh Ali. He's from the family of Abdul Rasul, the family that they found the cachette of the mummies in 1881. And he was the last member of the family to be there. Once he took me from my hand to the tomb of Seti I, one of the most beautiful tombs in the Valley of the Kings. He said, young man, this is a tunnel. Goes down for 300 feet. He said, in 1960, I took a permission with my people. Can we please stop this? The man in 1960, he took a permission to excavate the tomb and to find the treasures of this tomb. But the workmen could not breathe, and this is why they stopped him. He told me, if you become an important archaeologist, please excavate this treasure. If you discover anything, which I believe the tomb of Seti I is still inside this tunnel, the only thing that I need from you to tell the people that I'm the one who told you about this. I said, okay, Sheikh Ali. I forget about this story until 2002. When I became the head of antiquities, I came to look at this tunnel. I took a very thick rope in my hand, a flashlight, and a measure tape. I found I did reach 252 feet. Then I pushed the rope and the workmen took me out. They did this for a TV in Los Angeles, and the film director took it for the Emmy Television Award, and they decided also to give me the Emmy Television Award. In 2005, we began the most important work that took us about 7 years to work, to discover the secrets of the tomb of Seti I. We had to cover the burial chamber was closed to protect the scenes. We opened the tunnel, and we found that the tunnel was restored with wood like this in the ancient times. Our method actually is to excavate the tunnel and restore the ceiling with iron frame. And that is the method that we began to think we can do all over all the tunnel from up to down. We began to excavate. I put this wooden stairs, then we can walk above it. And also for the workmen to take the dirt and the sand from down up, it will be difficult. Therefore, we had to make cars like this to bring all the dirt and the sand out. And this really helped us to reveal lots of important things of this tunnel. In the middle of the tunnel, we found artifacts like shawaptis, small statuettes, inscribed blocks with the name of Seti I. And we did continue working until this area, we found a model of a boat made of faience. And Sheikh Ali's workmen did work until they stopped her, 300 feet exactly. And instead of them excavating the tunnel and go further, they did go in the left, in the wrong way. We did continue our work in the tunnel, and we found the most impressive thing. We found these steps. When the steps has been found, we do not need to do frames of iron anymore, because the tunnel is cut in the solid rock. We excavated in front of the steps, and we found in this area here wooden beams that the ancient Egyptians used to transport the stones on it. And we found that the four steps became 37 steps. Became amazing. And it's carved in the rock like this. I went down after that to see what's behind the 37 steps. We had to put wood here with ropes. I had to go down to find out how this really, look, it has gates. Like there is a tomb within a tomb. Hieroglyphic inscription. It say, widen the tomb and raise it up. And also, we did continue. I stayed in this place for about 8 hours, trying to reveal the secrets of this tunnel. Then I thought I should go out. I was so exhausted, I could not walk. It's almost now 1,060 meters that we did exceed over 250 feet more than what Sheikh Ali's workmen did. I could not go out. The workmen put me in cars like this and they pushed me up. And that was the way to save me. I met my assistants outside, Tariq and Mustafa, and I told them, we are in front of a major important discovery. There is a tomb inside a royal tomb. I was leaving to the States next day to give lectures. I told them, don't work, don't do anything until I come back. 1 week in the States, I did not sleep 1 minute. I was thinking about what could be discovered inside that. We came, look, the tomb of Siti the First is almost 98 meters. And Sheikh Ali's people excavated about 300 feet, 100 meters. We found until now double of the space of what Sheikh Ali's found. Is this could be a symbolic tunnel, like the tunnel routes for the caves of Osiris? At the end of this tunnel, could be snakes waiting for us? We did continue working. We found more steps, and we could see the walls. We have gates like this, and the walls began to be divided to receive scenes. Ancient Egyptians, when they began to put scenes on a tomb, they made a grid. And that are the points of the grid they were planning, means that was planned to be a tomb inside a tomb. We found another 54 steps. We went down the steps, and when I did reach the end, we found it's completely dead end. After 175 meters and a half. I was not disappointed, but look what happened. The workmen finished this and left this unfinished. Then when they were working here, someone came and said, the king is dead. If the king is dead, everyone has to stop working. And therefore, Siti the First ruled for 12 years. He could not continue building a tomb inside the tomb. And you can see, this is completely finished, this is unfinished. Then the workmen left the tomb, and Ramses II, his son, buried him quickly. And this is why I believe in the tomb of Ramses II, outside in the Valley of the Kings, inside this tomb, Ramses II should have a tomb, inside a tomb, because he ruled for 66 years. And this could be a time for him to build a tomb in this valley. The Valley of the Kings became silent after the tomb of Tutankhamun. But in 2005, another tomb was found, KV63, which is in front of the tomb of Tutankhamun. And inside, 8 coffins, 28 big pottery jars. This tomb has been announced to be the tomb to be discovered after the tomb of Tutankhamun. And actually, I believe that this tomb could be the cachet, the embalming cachet of Ankh Isin Amun, the wife of Tutankhamun. Now, can you believe that the 63 tombs found in the Valley of the Kings was found by foreigner? No one single tomb was found by an Egyptian. My dream came to true, to excavate the Valley of the Kings and to work behind the tomb of Merimbetah, the son of Ramses II. His tomb is here. And this is the area that we began our excavation first. We found graffiti everywhere. This is a graffiti left by someone who built the tomb for his father, the high priest Amunacht. We began to excavate in the cliff. It took us 9 months removing all these huge blocks away until we found this hole and a man-made wall like this. I found that this is the area that received the tears of the gods. And the tears of the gods are the flood that comes from the top and go down. The ancient Egyptian made a route for the flood to go down until it can go outside of the valley to protect the tombs. Even they built dams to stop the pushing of the flood. This is the first discovery that we made. Also, we found when they choose to build a tomb, when they make a mistake, they abandon the tomb. But we found next door is an area for the workmen to sit down, and they put their food in this area here. We found the name of a queen. Her name is Tia. And also, we began to excavate in front of the tomb of Tutankhamun because people said there is another tomb, KV64, should be existed here, and another tomb under the inspector's house. The English guy who really thought about this, we excavated and we found this crack. He made the interpretation of a crack like this to be a tomb. It's not a tomb. We demolished the antiquities inspector office and we excavated underneath. We did not find anything there. But we began to excavate in front of the tomb of Tutankhamun, where we found workmen huts, the houses and the huts that the workmen used to live in it while they were excavating and building the tombs of the pharaohs. We found one intact hut. Inside was a basket made of mats like this. But for the most important thing is really stratigraphy. How can you study the stratigraphy of the site through our excavations? Each period of time from dynasty 18 up to dynasty 20s can show what kind of people really actually used the Valley of the Kings. But we found scenes of a queen giving offering. We found the name of a king, year 9, of the name of a king. We found a workman was thinking of his girlfriend. Then what he did, he drew her picture in front of him, actually, then he can look at her all the time. We found also they take absence of the workman. You know, like today, if you go to work, they take you attended or not. Then the ancient Egyptian workmen used to write their first name, and they came to work. And also, we began to excavate in this valley called the Valley of the Monks, next to the Valley of the Kings. They called it the Valley of the Monks because in one of the tomb of King Ai, they have monks as scenes from the Book of the Netherworld. We found a foundation deposit. What is a foundation deposit? Before the ancient Egyptian built a temple, they make a hole, and they put in the hole wood and bones and pottery as an announcement of the building of the temple. But building a tomb is different, because when they built a tomb, they made 4 foundation deposits. We found 4 foundation deposits. Pottery, blue pottery dated to Amenhotep III, knives and a small pottery. All these 4 foundation deposits, and look at this stir. I really believe in this area, the tomb of Ankhes in Amun, the wife of Tutankhamun, should be buried in this area, and this really our next work that we should do. But we're so lucky to rediscover tombs. Those are the tombs of the domesticated animal of this king, Amenhotep II. And all these tombs were completely hidden for 100 years. No one really knew what happened to them. We began to look for these tombs, and we were able to find King's Valley number 53. This is the entrance of the tomb. We went down until we can see it's 5 meters down. This has been excavated 100 years ago. But look, when we re-excavated this again, we found bones. And we found canopic jars with a sign and hieroglyphic, pieces of gold inside this tomb. Canaanite pottery came from Palestine. And we found out that this tomb was buried for 3 people, a man and his wife and his son. And actually, the man was the overseer of the scribe in the place of justice. And this is the plan of this small tomb. We are doing radar now, trying to reveal more secrets of the valley. But I'm really hoping that the tomb of Ankhes Amun could be our goal to be discovered in the Valley of the Kings. And actually, I'm very proud of my team that trained in the excavation techniques, and this team really is working and making all these wonderful discoveries. Tutankhamun. When I received the CT scan from the National Geographic as a gift, I decided to scan the mummy of Tutankhamun. But when I was trying to do that, I found that all the media from everywhere want to come after me. Means I will never do any work. Then what I decided to do is not to tell anyone. I left Cairo at 5 in the morning. I went to Luxor. I stayed in my hotel until 5 in the evening. When all the tourists left the valley, I did arrive at the Valley of the Kings. And guess what I found? The Japanese TV. The Japanese knows everything. You cannot hide anything. When I make an interview to the Japanese TV, a big storm happening, and it was raining. The Japanese ran away, saying the curse of Tutankhamun, the curse of Tutankhamun. It reminds them what happened to Lord Carnarvon when he died 3 months after the discovery of the tomb. We took these glasses out, and after that we took the third golden coffin out, and I had another beautiful moment in my life, meeting King Tut face to face, looking at his buck teeth, like the buck teeth of the mummy of Tutmosis III at the Cairo Museum. In 1925, Howard Carter took the three coffins above, from the, above the mummy, and he found that the golden mask is tied completely in the face of the mummy. He tried to take it out, he couldn't. He took the mummy outside in the sun to take the mask out, he couldn't. Then he brought tools made of fire, and he took the golden mask out, and he damaged the mummy to 18 pieces because of this beautiful golden mask as a masterpiece of Egyptian art. This is how the mummy looks like, completely. And what's really amazing, that Howard Carter left the head of the mummy with linen like this. In 1968, when they did X-ray, they damaged this linen completely. We took the mummy out and put the mummy in the CT scan machine. 1 minute after this photograph was taken, the machine was stopped. And it was the first time in my life to think there is something could be called the curse of Tutankhamun. I was so miserable until we brought a cooler, and the cooler made the machine to work. I brought the mummy back. I found this card left by Howard Carter. I wrote my name with my team's name, and we put it beside the mummy to say that this is the first time that the mummy of Tutankhamun was completely scanned. The mummy of Tutankhamun thought by everyone that he was murdered because of that hole in the back of the head. We found out that this is not true. It was opened in Dynasty 18 to put the liquid for mummification. But we found this fracture in the left leg. It shows that he died 2 hours. 2 hours before he died, had this accident. But this accident cannot cause his death. It should be something else that I will tell you later. But we began to do forensic techniques to reconstruct the face of Tutankhamun. We had three teams. We had an Egyptian team, an American team, and a French team. I gave the images to the American team. I did not tell them that this is King Tut. And they did reconstruct the face of someone who does not like King Tut at all. When I gave it to the Egyptian team, I told them, this is King Tut. And they began to work, and they did reconstruct the face of someone who doesn't look like King Tut at all. But the French team were very smart, and they worked very hard, and they did reconstruct the face of someone who looks French. All of them agreed in the shape of the nose and the shape of the head, but they can't know the color of the head and the color of the face. When I brought the mummy back, I found that the mummy is in danger because of the breathing of the tourists and also because of the dust that comes inside. We had to design a showcase from Germany and put it inside the tomb, and I came with my team, and we began to move the mummy for the first time and put it inside the showcase. When you go to Egypt and you enter the mummy of Tutankhamun, you'll find the face of the mummy is clear in front of you. Now, we began to think about for the first time to actually begin to study for the family of Tutankhamun, because we do not know who's the father. Is he Amenhotep III? Is he Akhenaten because of this block? Tutankhatun, son of a king, Ankhes in Baatun, daughter of a king? Is Akhenaten? We don't know. Who's the mother? Kia or Nefertiti or T? We really don't know. And this is why, what we have of Tutankhamun? We have this mummy of Yuya and the mummy of Tuya. Yuya and Tuya were the father and the mother of Queen T, who married Amenhotep III. And also we have the mummy of Tutankhamun. Then we have only these mummies. But in the same time, we have suspect mummies that could be related to King Tut, but we are not sure. Like these two mummies in KV 35. One is the elder lady and one is the younger lady. We also have this mummy, could be Akhenaten, that found in KV 55. And this mummy was found in this coffin that is now in the Cairo Museum. We also have the two fetuses that found in the tomb of Tutankhamun, studied by X-ray before. One could be 7 and one could be 9 years old. Now, we begin our work for the CT scan and the DNA for the first time. We built two DNA labs, one in the basement of the Cairo Museum, one in Faculty of Medicine. The two labs separate from each other. Each lab had a team completely different from each other. And the CT scan work, we have Dr. Sahar Selim is with us tonight. She was one of the leader teams working in the CT scan of this project. Then they began to take samples from the mummy. I never really thought in my life that DNA could work with mummies. And to show how they take the liquid and they put it in pipes like this. Then the first lab made the discovery. And the second lab confirmed what the first lab said. And we sent all the results to JAMA. And JAMA approved our work after 8 months. And I had to make a press conference at the Cairo Museum, announce the discovery of Tutankhamun family. What we found, KV55 mummy, is the mummy of Akhenaten. But all this, he was, all the shapes of a woman or a man together did not really exist in the mummy. This what really written in the poem of Akhenaten. They say you are the father, you are the mother. Then the artist put the feminine and the masculine in the art style. Then Akhenaten was not really like this. We found that this mummy, the elder lady in KV35, is the mummy of Queen T. Actually, in the tomb of Tutankhamun, Howard Carter found this coffinet with the name of Queen T and this piece of hair. They compared this piece of hair with this and they found it's identical. Means now we can confirm that the elder lady is Queen T. Queen T was the most important lady married Amenhotep III. The younger lady that thought before to be Nefertiti is not Nefertiti. This is the mother of Tutankhamun, and she was the daughter of Amenhotep III and Queen T. The two fetuses, we found they are a female, the female children of Tutankhamun, and we did some work with them and two mummies in KV21. We thought that this could be Queen Ankhes in Amun, and the other one, the headless mummy, could be Nefertiti. And this actually is our project that we're having coming soon in the future. But we have all the family of Tutankhamun, but we hope that the statue of Nefertiti could be discovered. Then what we are missing with the family is Ankhes in Amun and Queen Nefertiti, and the whole family is now seen. How Tutankhamun died? We found out he has a flat foot. The second, blood doesn't go to his fingers. Means he was a disabled person. If you go to archaeology, you'll find he had 130 sticks. In this stick, he said, I made it by myself. When he's standing on a stick, shooting, sitting, not standing, means he was a disabled person. And this is why I believe that Tutankhamun died from an accident, could be a chariot, because of this. And also, at the same time, he had malaria. The malaria and all the problems that he had could cause his death. How we discovered the mummy of Queen Hatshepsut? This is another major discovery that we made. Queen Hatshepsut was a powerful lady, ruled for almost 20 years. Her architect Senmut built for her this beautiful temple at Deir el-Bahri. We had to look at all the mummies in the Cairo Museum or in the Valley of the Kings that the left hand is in the chest. If this happened, means she was a queen or a princess. We went in KV60. Where we found this mummy. The left hand is in the chest. I took all this mummy to the Cairo Museum. I began to enter the tomb of Hatshepsut. It's so dangerous, almost 300 feet. The only way to go inside the tomb is using ropes like this. And after they go to the cachette of the mummies, because in this cachette found this box that contain the liver of Queen Hatshepsut. And her name is written in hieroglyphic like this. I had to take this box and put it in the CT scan. Look what we found. In the CT scan, we found the liver, a piece of the stomach, and look at this. This is one tooth. It's a molar. Looking at this, we began to look with expertise and radiologists at all the mummies. We found one mummy has a gap. And that gap actually is this what has been found in the mummy, and this what has been found in the box. It can go like this. Each other means that this actually mummy is the mummy of Queen Hatshepsut. She was obese, died in the age of 55. She had diabetes and she died because of cancer, means Thutmose the Third did not murder her, as it's written in all the historical books. The last important project that we did is with this king, the last pharaoh fighter of Egypt, Ramses the Third. There was a conspiracy from his harem against him. His wife and his son Bentaur tried to kill him. In the harem conspiracy, they say he was saved from this. But when we did the CT scan, we found out he was murdered with a sharp knife. I mean, his son succeeded to kill him, but he never took the throne. Ramses the Fourth took the throne. And we found in the Cairo Museum that this actually mummy, unknown man E, is the mummy of his son Bentaur. And this really a discovery that was just announced 2 months ago. I take you back to the site that I spent most of my life working and excavating in the pyramids. And I always take the top of the Great Pyramid to look at any site before I do excavations. First of all, the Sphinx. We restore the chest all the time. And recently, we did the scanning by laser of every stone of the Sphinx. What is the legend of the Sphinx? People think, because of the dream stealer, there is something is hidden underneath the Sphinx. And there is legend of people all over the world who think about this. And they always ask me, we need to drill underneath the Sphinx to prove there is something is hidden underneath. And I would say no. Until recently, the water table began to rise. We had to drill outside the Sphinx. But the drilling showed that the water table is 5 meters down. I had to bring a machine from the States with an angle like this. It goes down for almost 60 feet and it goes in the other side. And also another drilling in the middle. And we took photographs. We found there is no people from Atlantis. There is nothing is hidden under the Sphinx. The Sphinx is a solid rock and a living rock, and really nothing is hidden underneath. But are there any secret tunnels in the Sphinx? The answer is yes. And all the man who was working for me, he said, if you remove a stone from the Sphinx tail, you'll find a tunnel. But he said that everyone who entered in this tunnel, there is always a curse happened to him. I told them, don't worry about the curse. We took the stone out. And we entered inside. We found there is a tunnel inside the Sphinx for about 45 feet. But as you see, I was smart. I did not get in first. I sent an American friend of mine before me, and he actually took many curses in his life. When President Clinton came to Egypt, and I took him, and I showed him this tunnel, I told him the same story. He smiled, and he looked at me, and he said, you know, if I entered in this tunnel, I will not have a curse like the one that I had in my life. And you know what he meant by this. Behind the Sphinx, there is another shaft that many people think from this shaft, there is a tunnel to the Great Pyramid and a tunnel to the Sphinx. This happened 12 years ago. I came down. I excavated this tunnel 60 feet under the ground. I found that the tunnel was full of water. I had to bring young people like this. I tie them with ropes and I throw them in the Nile, on the water. I did not abuse them. They loved to do that. I brought machines sucking the water from down until we found remains of 4 pillars. Inside this water, there is a sarcophagus. And this is a symbolic burial of the god Osiris. Osiris was a myth. When we opened the sarcophagus, there is nothing inside that one. But there is another tunnel in the west wall. I sent another boy. He went for about 5 meters, and the tunnel began to be very narrow. I was searching for optic camera for 10 years. Until recently, we had an optic camera. And I found that the water is covering the shaft again. We had to build this wood. And with an English team, we had to send the optic camera. But the optic camera could not work. It went only for 20 meters. And it was stopped because of the mud. I brought a Japanese team. And the Japanese team put the optic camera inside the tube like this. And actually, it went for almost 70 meters. But also the mud stopped the optic camera. I have to look for a snake robot. And this designed by this unique guy from Washington, D.C. which really soon we are going to use this snake robot. And this actually is one of the reasons that they call me in the States Indiana Jones. And even this guy, Josh, who's a very famous in the TV Discovery Channel, he came on my birthday with a gift. And that was the whip of Indiana Jones. And even George Lucas, who created and invented the Indiana Jones character, he came with his own jet, with his four adopted children to meet me. We had dinner together, and he asked me why your hat became more famous than Harrison and Ford hat. I told him my hat is a genuine archaeological hat, but Harrison Ford hat is fake. Now, people will never stop having theories about the Sphinx and about the pyramid. There is a cave. They say this cave goes for thousands of meters under the ground. I came to excavate this tunnel. We found it is a tomb for animals dated to the late period. I had to stop the excavation because of bats. And I really hate bats. Now, the most important discovery that we made are the tombs of the pyramid builders that we found south of the pyramid. This discovery proved that pyramids built by Egyptians, not by people who came out of the space, as people say, and also they were not slaves because they built their tombs near the pyramids. We found tombs of the workmen who moved the stones, all the back of the skeleton of the workmen had a stress on their back. They were involved in moving heavy stones. This person had a cancer, and also statues. We found statues. And look, in this tomb, we found a man who put a curse inscription saying, if anyone will disturb my tomb, he will be eaten by crocodile, the hippo, and the lion. His wife, on the other side, left the same inscription, but she added to the three animals, she said, and the scorpion and the snakes also will eat you. And this to show that women take revenge more than men. I'm talking about ancient times, not about today. Look at how archaeology is fun. When you excavate a tomb like this, and you, after 1 month, you can see inside the tomb a face of a statue. When you take the mud brick out, the statue is clear. But when you took this stone, you have a surprise. There are four statues representing one person in different ages. We found recently these tombs. Look. The overseer of the workmen had a big tomb. Beside him are the workmen who worked under him. Because the workmen who built the pyramid, and this to show, they are poor people, pottery and bones. The workmen who built the pyramids were divided to gangs. Each gang has a name. Like if you look inside the five chambers of the Great Pyramid, you'll find a name of a gang, Friends of Khufu. Then each gang had a name, and each gang had an overseer. We found recently more tombs of priestesses located next to the tombs of the pyramid builders. And this to show that how all these tombs were separated from the pyramid by this wall. The workmen would go underneath, they work in the pyramid, and they come back. The pyramid was a national project of the whole nation. Every household in the north and the south participated in building the pyramid by sending workforce or food to help the king. This is why I'm saying always, building pyramids built Egypt. What is the secret of the Great Pyramid? People use radar to discover the secret of the Great Pyramid. You have three tombs, one underneath, one in the middle, and the third one. I closed this pyramid for a year to stop humidity. We had to clean the salt in the walls of the pyramid. And we had to clean this tunnel, 20 by 20 centimeters. I talked to a German robot, and he designed a robot called Web Wawat, means name of a god, means opener. And this is the shape of the robot. And we sent the robot in the northern tunnel. After 19 meters, the tunnel began to bend, and the German robot could not bend. We sent the robot in the south tunnel. After 60 meters, it stopped in front of a door with two copper handles. When I became explorer to the National Geographic, I told them, make this robot, and they called it Pyramid Rover. We had to make it live. I told the people to know that we are not hiding anything. And we opened one hole, 1 centimeter and 1 millimeter. And we sent a camera after 21 centimeter behind this door, we found a second one without copper handles. Why these doors has two copper handles? If you go to the Cairo Museum and you see the canopic jars of Tutankhamun, it has copper handles for ropes to pull them. When we finished exploring the south one, went to the northern one. 19 meters, it's bending. North and the south for 8 meters. And the reason for the bending was to avoid the Grand Gallery. But after 60 meters, another third door were found with two copper handles. I really believe that Cleopatra's chamber is still hidden inside the pyramid. And maybe they are located behind this door. I had to bring people from Hong Kong, from Singapore, and they made experiment until they made this robot. They called it Jidi, a name of a magician who made Khufu, and this really is a project that I hope that we can continue with this English team to reveal the secrets of the pyramid for the first time. I told you about things that I discovered. I will tell you about something that we may discover. Near Alexandria, you have this temple called Tabu Ziris Magna. We believe inside this temple, there is the tomb of Cleopatra and Mark Antony. It is not really my theory. The theory of a lady from the Dominican Republic, she came and convinced me that in this temple, there is the tomb of Cleopatra. And we had Egyptian team working with her. And we began our work for the last 5 years. Inside this square, we found a coin of Alexander the Great. And we found a statue of Cleopatra. We found many tunnels, goes down for 200 meters under the ground. And this tunnel was really difficult. When I entered inside this tunnel, I could not go more than 9 meters, but the tunnel goes for 30 meters. I had to wait until we brought a machine. And that machine, they put me in that machine. I went down for 25 meters, and the machine stopped. They could not take me down, up. I had to stay in that tunnel for 3 hours until they did fix that machine, and they took me up. And after that, we found in this area a headless royal statue, which is made of granite. We found also a head of Cleopatra. We found also a statue of Aphrodite. And we found coins has the shape and the name of Queen Cleopatra. And we found this mask. It has a cleft on the chin. My assistant asked me, he said, do you think that this mask belong to Mark Antony? I said, no, it belongs to Richard Burton. Now, we are using radar, try to really see the location of this tomb. But we found the northern entrance of the temple, which we found a statue of Isis, and we excavated outside, and we actually could see a big, large cemetery with golden mummies directed to this temple, which really we hope that this tomb of Cleopatra and Mark Antony could be discovered soon in this area. You know, as I told you, I showed you, archaeology is really fun. And sometimes you can reach sites with horses like this. And sometimes, because I do lots of movies for TV, they had a body double for me. And the big difference of this guy of me, that his ass is twice the size of my ass. Then I had to tell them to change this guy and find someone similar to me. And also at the same time, you meet people like Queen Beatrix, Queen Sophia of Spain. She came to visit me almost in every excavation that I did. Brooke Shields and also Tony Blair. His children came to see the tombs of the pyramid builders. The old lady came to visit and she brought all the wives. Laura also came as the wife of Mr. Bush. And I took her to see my excavation, and I gave her this book. And actually, I went to Dallas a few years ago to give a lecture and to visit King Tut exhibit. And she asked me to take her to the exhibit. During the exhibit, she told me that Mr. Bush is sitting home watching me in the TV, and he wants my hat. I gave her a copy of my hat, and next day she said that the head of Mr. Bush was big, and he needs a bigger hat. I had to send him a FedEx hat, X large. Mrs. Clinton and Chelsea came, and also Tony Blair and his wife came to visit. I had to invite them for lunch on my expense at Mina House in hope that they would pay something to our museums, and they never paid anything. Also, Queen Sonia of Norway, and you have also Hugh Jackman. He came to Egypt because I'm a good friend of Jeffrey Katzenberg, a famous film director. And this is his wife. But what's really funny, during my explanation to them, a big group, American group, were shouting. And his wife told him, you should go and tell them thank you. He did go and told him thank you. They said, no, we're not shouting for you. We're shouting for Zahi Hawass. And he came again with Ben Stiller and Chris Rock. They entered the pyramid with me. And again, Goldie and Susan and all of these people, and even Jacqueline Bisset and Groves, they came to the pyramids. And even Shakira did sing in front of the pyramid. And of course, this is Elle Macpherson. She's twice taller than me. Her son had to enter inside the Sphinx. And this is Michael Bay, who's Megan Fox, and they were shooting Transformer 3 at the pyramids. And Beyonce, I had a big fight with her. And Salima Hayek and her. But this is funny. This is Greg Norman, the famous golf man, and he married Chris Evert, the tennis lady. Matt Lauer from today's show called me. He said, Greg and Chris, they would like to come to meet you and get married in front of the Sphinx. When they came, I told Chris, why are you crazy? The Sphinx has a curse. You will stay 1 month and he will divorce you after that. He said, no, we are in love. 1 month later, they get divorced. And this is the famous visit of Mr. Obama. When he turned it to the other side, he saw this hieroglyphic sign. And he said, I look like this. And I told him, it's true, you look like this. And I gave him my hat, and he stayed at the pyramids for almost 2 hours. And you have crazy people like this lady, and Dr. Ruth also came to visit me many times. But my favorite lady was always Lady Di. But I have to tell you a story. When I was young, I wanted really to be a lawyer. But when I bought the books of law, I hated law. But I went to archaeology by accident. I graduated from archaeology. I decided to be a diplomat. I hated the people in the archaeology department. But I failed to be a diplomat. I came back to antiquities by force. They sent me to do excavations. And I never know, understand what's been excavation. The workmen found the tomb. And they asked me to come to excavate the tomb. In the middle of the tomb, I found this statue. I began to clean the statue, and this one I said, I found my love, archaeology. And I had to go to the Cairo Museum to look at the statue that really changed my life. And this is why I'm saying this always to young people, to you, in Kaust. To love something is not enough. To like something is not enough. But to give your passion to anything, you make it big. The passion is the most important thing. That's why I had a website for children, and I have a fan club that children from all over the world, they come. And of course, I don't know what happened that this hat became famous to them. And this hat brought $250,000 to the Children's Museum, that the first Children's Museum in Egypt that opened about 2 months ago. And the sales of this hat completely goes to the Children's Museum. When I go to the Valley of the Kings, and I see a young man like this, and I see the passion of archaeology in his heart. This makes me happy. I say always we found until now 30% of the Egyptian monuments. And still there 70% is buried underneath the ground. And I always say that you never know what the sand of Egypt may hide of secrets. And thank you.
Questions, please. I'm sure you have questions. Who wants to start?
You have questions?
You know, we, yeah?
Yeah, this young man.
Who wants to start, please?
Hi, question. How did they know that there was a tomb under the tomb, and how did they not mix tombs? You know, Because I assume that once they closed the tomb, it was completely buried and it was unseen from outside. There were no characteristics to actually say this is the tomb of such and such king, right? So let's say 16 or 20 or 30 years pass, people forget what the original tomb was, right? So how do they know that it was when they're trying to dig for a new tomb that there's no tomb there?
Who? Us?
No, the ancient Egyptians.
Because the ancient Egyptian, when they built the tomb, they tried to hide this tomb. But they know that in that period, they know that this tomb belonged to king so-and-so-and-so.
Oh, so they kept records?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And sometimes, of course, because all this are people inherit the knowledge from one person to the other person, then they really know for the period of the new kingdom, from dynasty 18 to dynasty 20th. This is why the tombs were robbed, because they know the location of the tombs. The only tomb that was saved was the tomb of Tutankhamun, because blocks came from the tomb of Ramses VI and did hide the entrance of that tomb. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.